My name is John Turner, and I'm so pleased you've decided to join me. Today, we're here to celebrate the career of a most iconic character. I'll give you a hint. The character in question happens to be the mascot of a similarly popular company. No, it's not Mickey Mouse, Bugs Bunny, or even Totoro. Not even the Minions. The character I'm talking about is an everyday fellow who makes his living as a plumber. He is also the star of numerous video games. One last clue. He has an appetite for mushrooms and flowers. Do you know who I'm describing? If not, here's the answer.
It's me, Mario.
Hello!
Nice to see you too. Yep, it's Mario, video game superstar, heroic plumber, mushroom consumer. He's all of that. When we speak of video games, it's hard not to mention him. After all, he is not only the hero of every game he's in, he has made similar impacts in the video game industry too. Indeed, Mario has had quite a career. And it all started with a...
monkey!
wait a minute, no, that's not quite right. Can we lose the monkey, please? Thank you. What I meant to say was, it started with a video game. An arcade video game called Donkey Kong, released in 1981 by a Japanese company called Nintendo. The game's premise is simple. A crazed ape, the title character, kidnaps the fair Pauline, and our hero must save her, dodging barrels and other obstacles on the way. This game also introduced gamers to the character who would come to be known as Mario. Believe it or not, though, he was not the first choice for the game's protagonist. Nintendo considered using Popeye and Bluto instead. But, unable to obtain any rights to these two, it was decided instead to cast a new creation. Thus, Mario was born. Initially, however, he was simply known as Jumpman, because that's what he basically did. In time, Jumpman was renamed Mario, after an Italian-American real estate developer and businessman named Mario Segale. You see, back in 1981, the fledgling Nintendo of America was renting one of Mr. Segale's warehouses for their headquarters. At one point, Segale berated the president, Minoru Arakawa, for falling behind in his payments. He was quite upset about it, and as a result of that incident, Nintendo dubbed him Super Mario. Little did anyone know that this nickname would make history. And make history it did in 1985, 4 years after Donkey Kong's release, when Nintendo introduced their all-new video game console, Nintendo Entertainment System, or NES for short. It would launch with a library of games that would take the US by storm, particularly Super Mario Bros. Aside from being a simple, addictively fun platformer, this game would introduce millions to Mario and his brother Luigi to the colorful Mushroom Kingdom and its quirky cast of characters, like the lovely Princess Peach, the perky mushroom retainer Toad, the lovable dinosaur Yoshi, and the ferocious, fire-breathing turtle villain, Bowser, King of the Koopas. Like Donkey Kong, the premise for Super Mario Bros. Was simple. Mario and/or Luigi must run, jump, stomp, and swim through stage after stage of obstacle courses, fighting enemies along the way in order to save the princess and her kingdom from Bowser and his minions. On their journey, gamers collect power-ups like mushrooms, fire flowers, and invincible stars. Super Mario Bros. Was a big success, and soon multiple sequels followed. With each entry, gamers would meet old and new friends, as well as enemies, all while traveling to different worlds, even outer space. But the goal was always the same: beat Bowser and rescue the princess.
Yay!
Credit for the appeal of Super Mario Brothers goes to the creative geniuses who gave birth to this lovable plumber, especially a certain Shigeru Miyamoto. Born in Japan on November 16, 1952, Mr. Miyamoto is the man who created Mario, as well as numerous other popular franchises, like The Legend of Zelda, Donkey Kong, Star Fox, and Pikmin. And then, of course, there's Mr. Koji Kondo, composer, pianist, and sound designer, whose accomplishments have been adored by millions. It was he who created the melodies of Super Mario that we all know and love. Over the years, Mario and Company have appeared in more than 20 games spanning multiple genres: sports games, racing games, and even role-playing games, RPGs for short. To this day, these characters remain popular with gamers everywhere. Yet for all his video game successes, Mario has struggled to achieve the same status at the cinema. It's a rather difficult venture to begin with. How can a video game superstar become a movie star? Well, that's what we're here to talk about tonight. So for the next hour, come join us as we explore Super Mario on the big screen, a story of challenges, false starts, the quirky, the bizarre, and ultimately, success. As they say, it's time to get this show on the road.
Let's go!
For children growing up in the late 1980s, their first experience of spotting Mario on television, aside from games, was this.
Hey, paisanos! It's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
We're the Mario Brothers, and plumbing's our game. We're not like the others who get all the fame. If your sink is in trouble, you can call us on the double. We're faster than the others, you'll be hooked on the brothers.
Unapologetically cheesy, the Super Mario Brothers Super Show, produced by Dink Enterprises, premiered on American television on September 4th, 1989. About 4 years after the release of the original Super Mario Brothers video game. In each episode, Mario, Luigi, Toad, and the Princess go up against the evil King Bowser Koopa and his baddies with rather unsurprising outcomes. Basically, it was the same thing over and over and over again, with minimal surprises. Sometimes the writers attempted to shake things up by setting our heroes and villains in settings based on literature and pop culture. Yes, even Star Wars. Yet no matter what, each episode culminated with the villain getting his comeuppance and our heroes saving the day. In between these animated escapades were live-action segments featuring Mario and Luigi, portrayed by Lou Albano and Danny Wells, respectively, with sitcom-style humor and occasional guest cameos. All this happened every Monday through Thursday each week, except on Fridays, when viewers would see episodes of another Nintendo favorite.
This is the Triforce of Wisdom, Link. The evil wizard Ganon has the Triforce of Power. Whoever gets both Triforces will rule this land forever. You must help me, Link.
Hey, for you, Zelda, anything.
In case you're wondering, Nintendo had very little say on how these characters in either Mario or Zelda should be portrayed, for they were mostly hands-off on the project. The Super Mario Bros. Super Show lasted for 65 episodes, and was followed by two other TV spin-off cartoons.
Super Mario, Super Mario, Super Mario World.
Super Mario World.
Although these cartoons were sadly short-lived, fans of the Super Mario franchise adored all of it, even if they were little more than your standard Saturday morning cartoon fare. Interestingly, however, these cartoons were not the first time Mario and company were brought to animation. Back in 1981, when Nintendo was advertising Donkey Kong, animated commercials were broadcast on TV, featuring Mario, then known as Jumpman, as well as Pauline and Donkey Kong in cartoon form.
Kids, you want to help get Donkey Kong? Give me a crunch!
There was also another short-lived animated series called Saturday Supercade, which features different video game characters in various segments. Naturally, Mario, Pauline, and Donkey Kong were among them. What isn't widely known is that there was a Japanese animated feature which bears the distinction of being the first ever to be based on a video game. It's called Super Mario Bros. The Great Mission to Rescue Princess Peach. Released briefly in theaters on July 20th, 1986, this hour-long movie is best described as a curiosity more than anything else. Although, as with Super Mario Bros. Super Show, it at least looks and sounds like its namesake. Well, sort of. As the film opens, we see our hero playing a video game when Princess Peach appears and literally jumps out of the TV. But just after she introduces herself to Mario, Peach is captured by Bowser, leaving behind a mysterious necklace on the floor. This necklace, we discover, can lead its owner to the Mushroom Kingdom, supposedly a land of treasure. The next day, a dog-like creature appears and steals the necklace. Both Mario and Luigi give chase, and of course, end up in said kingdom. There they learn from a bushy old hermit that Bowser has conquered the realm and intends to take Peach for his bride on Friday the 13th. In order to crash the wedding, so to speak, Mario and Luigi must find three power-ups: the mushroom, the flower, and the star, each guarded by Bowser's minions. Accompanied by their strange dog companion, the brothers set off to save the day, and maybe find treasure in doing so. At the time this film was made, there was only one Mario game available, and so there was little to work with. As such, things don't look quite like what gamers would expect. For instance, look at Luigi's uniform. Looks rather odd, doesn't it? But that's not the only peculiarity. The brothers own a grocery store instead of a plumbing business for reasons unexplained. Furthermore, the brothers each have differing personalities. Mario is portrayed as an absent-minded, hopeless romantic, while Luigi is a greedy gold digger. And that's not all. The mushroom retainers are female, and we see Koopa Paratroopas, who are gigantic, incidentally, having chicks. Yes, chicks! In between Mario and Luigi's encounters with Bowser's minions, we see some montages of their travels set to a catchy pop song. At another point, there is a musical number in which Mario imagines a romantic fantasy with Princess Peach. But perhaps the most unusual and arguably cruelest twist of all is that the dog companion turns out to be Princess Peach's fiancé. He was turned into a dog by Bowser, but the spell is broken when Mario returns Peach's necklace. Naturally, our hero is heartbroken, but still wishes the princess luck. I don't think diehard fans of Mario would be so forgiving of this, however. This movie is directed by Masami Hata, a longtime Japanese animation veteran, best known for works like The Sea Prince and the Fire Child, Ringing Bell, and Little Nemo, Adventures in Slumberland. Otherwise, little else is known about the production behind this feature. In fact, it has never been released stateside. That said, a group of fans did remaster the film in 4K and have made it available to view online. The Great Mission to Rescue Princess Peach is a strange interpretation of Super Mario, to be sure, But as mentioned, only one game was released at the time, and so you can only do so much with such limited lore. That's quite a resume for Mario's career on the small screen, isn't it? Hitting the big screen, however, was no easy feat, as we'll soon find out.
Till next time, everybody! Do the Mario!
Considering his popularity on video games and arguably TV, it was probably inevitable that Hollywood would come calling for Super Mario. But his first movie appearance wasn't what you would expect. In fact, it wouldn't be proper to call it a starring role at all. But The Wizard, released around Christmas in 1989, nonetheless is an interesting, if again curious, footnote in Mario's career. The plot is best described as a sort of Rain Man meets Tommy the Pinball Wizard hybrid, with about as much depth as, well, a video game. It's about three kids, one of who is a wizard, sort of, at playing video games, setting out for California to participate in a gaming tournament. Video Armageddon. In between, classic video games from the 8-bit era make surprise appearances, culminating with... what else?
I give you Super Mario Brothers 3!
That's the closest this movie gets to featuring Mario. If The Wizard sounds like a commercial for Nintendo games, well, that's pretty much what it is. A point further emphasized with references to Nintendo Power magazines and even accessories.
I love the Power Glove. It's so bad.
At one point, we even see one of the kids calling Nintendo's offices for advice. All of this was too much for the critics to take seriously, but to many gamers growing up in the late 80s, The Wizard was a real treat, if mainly to catch a sneak preview of Super Mario 3, which back then had not yet been released in America. Today, the film has a cult following, which probably means it's a great movie, right? Well, no, sorry. As mentioned, The Wizard is mainly appreciated by its target audience, for better or worse. But it does count as Mario's first cinema appearance.
Okie dokie!
Sometime after, word came out that an all-new Super Mario Brothers movie was coming to theaters. This one would be live-action, featuring some cutting-edge special effects. Naturally, there were millions of gamers who were looking forward to the new movie, myself included. But nobody could have guessed what it would turn out to be.
A long, long time ago, the Earth was ruled by dinosaurs. Then something happened. A giant meteorite struck the Earth. Goodbye, dinosaurs! But what if the dinosaurs weren't all destroyed? What if the impact of that meteorite created a parallel dimension where the dinosaurs continue to thrive and evolve into intelligent, vicious, aggressive beings? Just like us. And hey, what if they found a way back?
What? If you found all that confusing, well, you're not alone. So did audiences. Following this intro, the film gets even stranger from here. The picture flashes forward to modern-day Brooklyn by 1993 standards, where we meet Mario and Luigi, two plumbers not having much success. Incidentally, we also learn why they are called the Mario Brothers.
Name? Mario. Last name?
Mario.
Okay, what's your name?
Luigi.
Luigi?
No, Luigi Mario.
Okay, look, how many Marios are there between the two of you?
It's three. It's Mario and Luigi Mario.
Okay. The adventure starts when the brothers meet Daisy, a college-aged archaeologist, who quickly catches Luigi's eye. Daisy, incidentally, is the name of the princess from the Game Boy classic, Super Mario Land. Daisy wears a strange crystal around her neck, which is actually the missing piece of the meteorite which caused the... transdimensional disaster mentioned in the prologue. And evil King Koopa, incidentally portrayed as a cruel dictator-like president, or as he calls himself,
an evil, egg-sucking son of a snake,
has his greedy eyes set on both.
I need the rock and the princess Stacy, and I'll finally be able to merge our world with theirs and get rid of the mammals!
Princess? Did he just say princess? Yeah, sure enough, Daisy is indeed a princess. The only one who can bridge the gap between the two worlds. For that reason, Koopa has her kidnapped by his bumbling minions, cousins, Iggy and Spike. Mario and Luigi, of course, give chase.
I'm gonna kill him!
No, you're not gonna kill him, not if I get there first. I'm gonna break every bone in their body, and then I'm gonna kill him. I'm really gonna kill him.
The brothers then find themselves transported, not to the colorful, quirky Mushroom Kingdom at all, but instead a dark, gritty metropolis called Dinohattan. Yes, Dinohattan! It is a parallel dimension of New York City, populated by strange humanoid creatures who act like dinosaurs. Oh right, I forgot to mention that these guys are evolved dinosaurs. The rest of the film is a series of car chases, flamethrower shootouts, power struggles, betrayals, craziness, and some bizarre stuff about a fungus, and de-evolution, and evolution machines, guns, it's hard to explain.
Oh, man.
Bizarre couldn't be a more apt description for this whole movie. While previous incarnations of Super Mario Brothers may not have exactly been great television or cinema, at least they looked and sounded like the games they were based on. But this Super Mario Brothers goes in the opposite direction, and it doesn't just start with the change of setting. Many characters that gamers have come to know and love are given entirely new makeovers, and rather strange ones at that. These giant lizard-like stormtroopers, they're called Goombas. In the games, they looked something like this. This street punk with a guitar, it's Toad.
It's Toad?
Yep, Toad, a singer who was arrested as punishment for singing protest songs about Koopa. He is later turned into a Goomba by way of Koopa's de-evolution machine.
Goomba.
That's not even the half of it. Here are some other examples. Then there is Yoshi, who, like everyone else, gets a peculiar makeover. And get this, he's Koopa's pet.
Don't move your hands around like a small wounded animal.
But at least this movie gets one thing right.
He's got a papa!
Otherwise, it's far removed from its source material. Mario and Luigi don't even put on their trademark costumes until the final third of the movie. And guess what? It almost didn't happen.
Look.
Even the music doesn't sound like Super Mario Brothers. Aside from a familiar tune at the beginning of the movie, the actual score, composed by Alan Silvestri, is totally original. To be fair, Mr. Silvestri is a genius, and he does a serviceable job. But then you get these rock songs.
Love is the drug, and I need to score.
Open the door, get on the floor. Everybody want the dinosaur.
I won't stop the world for you, babe. Stop.
And to top it off, over the closing credits, there is this.
I love when
it's almost This song, incidentally, was supposed to be for another film, Disney's Hocus Pocus. Why it wound up here is hard to explain, as is pretty much the rest of the movie. Whatever it was, this film wasn't the Super Mario Brothers fans expected. So why did this movie turn out the way it did? The answer is a tale which, to quote one of the reviews of the movie, was pretty much chaotic and confusing. It all started in 1991 at an independent company called Leitmotiv, founded by Oscar-nominated producer Roland Joffé, best known for movies like The Killing Fields and The Mission. It was he who got the idea to turn Super Mario into a movie. He traveled to Nintendo headquarters in Kyoto, Japan, and convinced the late Hiroshi Yamauchi, then CEO, into providing him with a $2 million contract and creative control. Determining what direction he wanted to take the movie in, however, proved to be a challenge for Joffé. How does one transform a video game series into a full-length feature, especially one that isn't known for storytelling? Indeed, the script went through no less than 9 drafts, including one where Mario and Luigi travel through the Mushroom World to save Princess Hildy from Koopa. This version, which is a sort of Wizard of Oz kind of story with a touch of the Princess Bride for good measure, was as close in spirit to the games as possible. These concept art photos give an indication of what could have been. Greg Beeman was hired to direct, and prosthetic costumes were prepared for the various characters in the Mushroom World. Unfortunately, due to cost concerns and uncertainty about Beeman being suitable for the job, the pitch went out the window, or in this case, down the drain. So an all-new director had to be hired. It could be argued that the trouble really began when British husband and wife team Rocky Morton and Annabelle Jankel were brought in to direct the film. The couple were mostly known for music videos as well as a cult favorite TV show, Max Headroom, not motion pictures. But Rocky and Annabelle did provide something which intrigued Joffé, a certain style and edge to their work, particularly in the use of computer graphics. Based on this, Joffé decided that this would be a perfect fit for the Mario movie. Or so he believed. The problem? Jankel and Morton hated the script, and so they decided to create an all-new one about the dinosaur humans and the parallel city. Wait, hold on a minute. You're making a Super Mario movie, and the first thing you're gonna do is not make it at all like the games, and have it be dark and cynical instead? That doesn't sound like a great idea. But believe it or not, that's what Jankel and Morton had in mind. They wanted to create something along the lines of Batman. That film, the biggest moneymaker of 1989, successfully transferred Bob Kane's comic book character to a darker, more adult film, broadening its audience. That was what Jankel and Morton wanted to do. But their approach was curious, to say the least. There was a very hardcore movement against video games, and a lot of anti-video game sentiment, explains Morton. I wanted to make a film that would open it up and get parents interested in video games. It was this duo's idea that this movie should be a prequel to the games, a sort of origin story, if you will, which would culminate with Japanese executives appearing to our heroes with a special offer.
A video game based on your many adventures.
What would you call it?
Unfortunately, due to circumstances which will be discussed later, the scene ended up like this.
The Super Koopa Cousins!
You see, the idea was that the game in question would be an inaccurate retelling of what we see in the movie, due to lost in translation issues.
Mario Brothers.
Hi. Mario Brothers. Hi.
As strange as all this sounds, there was something sophisticated about the script Rocky and Annabelle envisioned that attracted many high-profile stars onto the project, including Bob Hoskins, John Leguizamo, Dennis Hopper, and Samantha Mathis. Never mind that it was based on such a phenomenally popular video game, a fact lost on Hoskins.
I didn't even know it was a game. It was my kids that told me. I said, what's your next film? I said, I'm doing Super Mario Brothers. Oh, that's the game. Oh, what? Yeah, here. And this is you. And I saw this thing jumping up and down. I thought, I used to play King Rhea.
However, 10 days before shooting was about to begin, Jaffe and his partner, Jake Eberts, began to have second thoughts. So without consulting the directors, they hired a new writer to provide a more lighthearted, family-friendly screenplay, disregarding everything that Rocky and Annabelle had conceived. Naturally, this caught the directors off guard.
We had to retrofit this brand new script within 10 days into the sets that had already been built and the props that had been made and everything.
The pressure was enormous. It was an incredibly complex production. So there was the main unit, there was a second unit, pickup unit, green screen, special effects, visual effects unit. And it was essentially guerrilla filmmaking. It was almost like documentary style filmmaking, but with very heavy duty equipment.
This was to be the first of many hasty, last-minute decisions which ultimately plagued the production of Super Mario Bros. As a matter of fact, it was turmoil from day one. The cast was not particularly complimentary of the directors. According to Dennis Hopper, Annabelle and Rocky were both control freaks and wouldn't talk before they made decisions. He wasn't alone in his misgivings. The crew expressed similar sentiments, unflatteringly nicknaming the couple, Rocky and Annabelle, the Flying Squirrel Show. Reports range from the directors getting into disagreements with the director of photography, and one instance where Morton poured coffee on an actor's costume because he wasn't dirty enough. Matters got worse when Hollywood studio executives got involved. Instead of a family-friendly film, they saw a movie trying to be as dark and adult as possible. In fact, the directors insisted on bringing in strippers, yes, strippers, for a bar scene. There was also this. Of course, the executives were horrified and insisted on eliminating all these edgy elements in exchange for more action and humor, like this.
I hope the guy downstairs knows where we're going.
Hey, this is driving!
Whoa, cool!
Rocky and Annabelle were really unhappy with what the studio was asking for, how they were trying to dumb things down. And they were. And they were trying to fight against that.
As a result of all this back and forth over the tone of this movie, the script was rewritten again, and again, and again, and again, and again, every day, to the point where it got frustrating for everyone.
As actors, we get confused a lot. You know, you would get a lot of different messages. I would get messages like, don't be so funny. Oh, can you be funny? How about funny in this scene? How about not so funny in this scene? How about a little, and it was like, oh.
Dennis Hopper was much more explosive. He got so angry that at one point, he lashed out at both the directors and the writers for what seemed like hours, slowing down production as a result. Bob Hoskins and John Leguizamo, on the other hand, started drinking on set as a coping strategy. This resulted in an incident in which Hoskins broke his finger. The reason? Leguizamo, driving drunk, braked too hard, causing the door to slam on Hoskins' hand. The latter would end up wearing a cast for the rest of the shoot. And that wasn't the only injury Hoskins received. He was stabbed 4 times, electrocuted, and was nearly drowned.
Oh no.
Meanwhile, Richard Edson and Fisher Stevens, who played Spike and Iggy, respectively, saw an opportunity to improvise some of their scenes, including a rap number which ultimately was cut from the film, even though the cast and crew seemed to like it.
Well, stop and think this through. It's time to get rid of you-know-who.
A radical development is taking place.
Iggy
and Spike will set the pace. Koopa!
At this point, it was clear that the project was in serious trouble. Not only had the shoot ballooned from 10 weeks to 15, the budget was escalating to the point where some concepts had to be abandoned. Rocky and Annabelle, for instance, wanted to have a grand showdown between Koopa and Mario on the Brooklyn Bridge. Instead, Koopa was blasted by Mario and Luigi with laser, de-evolving guns, transforming the villain first into a sort of T-Rex, humanoid thingy. It would have been awesome to see Koopa look like this throughout the film. Then, a monstrous T-Rex. And finally, into primordial slime. Gross, right? Eventually, Annabelle and Rocky were fired, and other directors, including Joffe, had to stand in to complete the rest of the shoot. By then, nobody had any idea on what they were doing anymore. In fact, during post-production, Annabelle and Rocky were locked out of the editing room. They had to get permission from the Directors Guild of America to get back in. In the end, however, there was nothing that could be done to salvage the runaway train. And when the film finally landed in theaters on May 28th, 1993, guess what happened? It crashed spectacularly. The critics were deeply offended, audiences were baffled, and diehard fans of Mario were quite disappointed. Super Mario Bros. Had cost $48 million to make and ultimately earned less than half of its budget. Not only that, but it was later bested by a far superior movie about dinosaurs.
Mamma Mia!
In the years since then, Super Mario Bros. Has been the subject of much ridicule. In spite of that, however, the film has developed a cult following, who today hail it as a misunderstood film. There's even a website dedicated to many behind-the-scenes stories about this movie. But back then, its failure was a serious detriment to everyone involved. Both Hoskins and Hopper expressed bitter disappointment. They called the whole experience a nightmare.
My six-year-old son at the time, he's now 18, at the time he said, Dad, I think you're probably a pretty good actor, but why did you play that terrible guy, King Koopa, in the Super Mario Brothers? And I said, well, Henry, I did that so you could have shoes. And he said, Dad, I don't need shoes that bad.
Hoskins was harsher. He called Super Mario Bros. The worst thing I ever did, and wished he had never participated on the project. For Rocky and Annabelle, the failure of the movie was the end of their careers in Hollywood. Nobody wanted to hire them to work on another film, and who could blame them? These two had produced one of the biggest flops in motion picture history, and a huge embarrassment to its source material. Worse still, it was not what they had set out to make.
I know what that film could have been. And that was the film that excited everybody. That was what excited the investors initially and excited the producers initially to embark on the project to make this film that that was our creation, Annabelle and mine, our creation together. But it de-evolved, a bit like the evolution chamber in the movie. It de-evolved into a whole different entity.
I think it was reviled quite vehemently by the big fans of the Super Mario Brothers games who felt, you know, possibly that we had done a great disservice to the game.
But it was Nintendo who was most affected by the Mario movie. In fact, they refrained from making any more deals with Hollywood studios for a long time due to this mess. Shigeru Miyamoto, interestingly, had the following to say about all this. He recognized that such projects are a challenge, especially the process of turning something as dynamic as an interactive game into a mere viewing experience. So I think that because these surrounding elements in these two different mediums vary so greatly, when you fail to take that into account, then you run into problems. Following the failure of the 1993 live-action movie, Mario and company stuck to their video games. But, sometime later, Bowser made a surprise cameo appearance in Disney's computer-animated video game-based comedy, Wreck-It Ralph. The film was a success, but still Nintendo remained very protective of its intellectual property, or IP for short. Then, in the early 2010s, Nintendo found itself facing hard times. Although the company had reasonable successes, their gaming revenue and console market share was declining due to stiff competition. Their sixth home console in particular, Wii U, was a misfire, appealing only to hardcore fans, but ignored by the public. Nintendo's new CEO, the late Satoru Iwata, suggested that it was time for Nintendo to branch out into other ventures, for instance, theme parks. So in 2015, Nintendo joined forces with Universal to create Super Nintendo World, which would become a division of Universal Studios Tokyo. Universal was no stranger to Nintendo. They had previously worked together as far back as 1989 on the aforementioned movie, The Wizard. Coincidentally, its climax sets in Universal Hollywood Resort. As a result of the partnership between Nintendo and Universal, an all-new Super Mario movie was announced in 2017. This time, the film would be computer-animated, and Nintendo would have creative control over the project, something they never did for any of the previous incarnations. Shigeru Miyamoto, in particular, wanted to make sure that this newest production would not be a repeat of the failed live-action film. We were fearful of all the failure of past IP adaptations, where there's a license and a distance between the original creators and the creators of the films, he says. The fans get outraged and mad because the studios didn't do justice to the original work. We really didn't want a backlash. It wouldn't be until April 5th, 2023, that the Super Mario Bros. Movie, as it was called, would premiere in theaters. Any concerns from fans over whether the new film would live up to expectations was quickly put to rest. This movie not only looks and sounds like Super Mario, it's great fun, too.
It's gonna rock!
As the picture begins, we see Mario and Luigi, two Brooklyn plumbers establishing a business. Or at least trying to. But, despite putting together a commercial of sorts, their efforts haven't exactly been successful so far.
If it isn't Brooklyn's favorite failures, the stupid Mario Brothers!
From the onset, we are given a good look at the brothers' personalities. Mario is bold and confident, but he has some problems. For one thing, he's a picky eater.
Ah, mushrooms!
Luigi, on the other hand, is cowardly, but he gets to have his moments.
You just got Haluigi'd!
Nonetheless, the two are a great team.
Hey!
We also get to meet some new characters, including Mario and Luigi's family.
Hey-o!
The trouble begins when Mario and Luigi attempt to save Brooklyn from a flood. Venturing into the sewers to find the cause, the pair come across a mysterious green pipe and are sucked into it.
Nothing can hurt us as long as we're together!
But in spite of Mario's reassurance, the pair are quickly separated. Mario ends up in the Mushroom Kingdom, populated by the lovable Toads, and of course, Princess Peach.
Let's see what you're made of.
Oh, I got this. No problem.
Meanwhile, Luigi ends up in the Darklands and is soon captured by Bowser and his army. Bowser has stolen the Superstar from the Kingdom of Penguins, but he has an even more ambitious agenda.
My army! Koopas! Yeah! Goombas! Whatever those things are! Soon we will arrive at the Mushroom Kingdom! Where after years of being sworn enemies, I will ask their princess to marry me in a fairy tale wedding! Yeah!
Doesn't she hate you?
Of course she hates me. But that makes me love her all the more.
The last Mario feature portrayed this villain as a different sort of king.
Tyrannosaurus Rex, the Lizard King, thank you very much.
But in this one, Bowser is in fine form, stealing his scenes with bombastic relish. At one point, he even gets to sing.
Peaches, 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 ah, oh, yeah.
Did I say sing? Well, screeching might be more accurate. Despite occasional comic moments like this one, he still comes across as quite vicious and cruel.
Find out who he is and what they're planning!
I'm on it, sire! May I lift the cover?
Not yet. Pain is the best teacher.
Princess Peach, incidentally, gets a big makeover in this film. Rather than being the damsel in distress, she is instead portrayed as a cool, confident leader, ready to stand up for her people.
We are going to stop Bowser.
How? Look at us! We're adorable!
In fact, she serves as Mario's mentor throughout their journey, teaching him about power-ups, training him, and even provide a bit of warmth. Better still, she gets to play a very active role in the climax, taking quite a stand against Bowser.
I'd never marry a monster.
Of course, Toad joins the pair on their journey.
Don't worry, I will protect you.
A Toad brave enough to join me?
I fear nothing.
And eventually, they cross paths with an old friend. Or rather, an old rival.
I'm Donkey Kong!
Another memorable cameo is Lumily from Super Mario Galaxy, who has a rather unique way of seeing things.
The only hope is the sweet relief of death.
Needless to say, the prisoners this character addresses don't take it very well. Based on all this, Nintendo's involvement in this movie is quite clear from the start. Directors Michael Jelenic and Aaron Horvath worked carefully with Mr. Miyamoto to ensure that everything looked just right.
Instead of being tangled up in your own thoughts, I like to mix ideas together, turn them around, and let them grow.
Like, Miyamoto-san was on calls with us. He showed us how to draw Bowser's nose. He's like, oh, Bowser has the nose of a tiger. And on his iPad, on a Zoom call, he drew Bowser's nose and held it up to the screen like this.
Miyamoto conceived some of the story ideas, too. It was his idea for Mario to have an aversion to mushrooms, a problem he eventually overcomes. Horvath and Jelenic were also huge fans of the games, although whether they were good at them was up for debate.
I was not terrible at the game.
You were terrible at one point.
I don't know about that.
Okay.
As with the first film, an all-star cast of actors were brought in to portray the characters. But casting Chris Pratt as Mario proved to be a curious choice for many. Long accustomed to Charles Martinet's Italian-accented falsetto, fans were concerned over whether Pratt could do Mario justice or not. Luckily, Pratt proved the naysayers wrong with a solid performance tinged with a Brooklyn accent.
You know what? Make fun of me all you want, but you were gonna help me find my brother.
Other choices like Charlie Day as Luigi, Anna Taylor-Joy as Peach, and especially Jack Black as Bowser were enthusiastically received from the start. As compensation, Charles Martinet did get to play some minor characters, One of them was Mario and Luigi's dad.
I think you're nuts.
As well as this guy from a pizzeria seen at the beginning of the movie.
It's a perfect! Wahoo!
Once the script and voice cast came together, the animation was produced in France at Illumination Studios in Paris. Here, a team of artists spent hours and hours breathing life to these memorable characters and realizing each location in staggering detail. Indeed, every area you see in this film, the Mushroom Kingdom, the Congo Jungle, the Spooky Forest, and Bowser's Castle Airship are not only amazing to gaze at, they look just like their video game counterparts. Better still, the film retains the spirit of playing the games. This is done effectively at the start, for example, in the scene where Mario and Luigi rush to their first job. This is played like the first level of Super Mario Bros., from the jumping, swinging, and running, and even the flagpole jump at the end. At one point, Mario struggles to get through an obstacle course complete with all the sorts of booby traps you would expect in a stage like this. Peach, naturally, shows him how it's done, with style. There are also several action scenes, the most spectacular of which is a dazzling Mario Kart-style race down Rainbow Road. It's a thrilling roller coaster ride of a sequence, which becomes even more so when Bowser's minions attack our heroes.
Split up!
Time to die, Mario!
The Super Mario Bros. Movie is also packed with Easter eggs. No, I'm not talking about those kind of Easter eggs. I'm talking about references to various Mario games. Aside from the aforementioned recreations of stages, there are power-ups and question blocks, recognizable outfits, including two classic ones, warp pipes, bricks, iconic sound effects, and all sorts of cleverly woven surprises, including references to different Nintendo games. There's even this familiar line woven into the script.
A princess, though, is in another castle.
Indeed, the charm of this movie is spotting moments like these. It's the sort of film that fans would want to watch again and again to catch them, to the point where you'll have to press pause to do so.
Watching it many times, you'll find all sorts of things, so everybody has fun looking.
The interesting thing about these Easter eggs is they're all very personal to us. They didn't just come from us, they came from the entire crew, and we have an entire crew of Mario fans.
There are so many Easter eggs in the Super Mario Bros. Movie that even I don't know how many there are. See if you can find them all.
Wahoo!
The same feeling is reflected in the music. Composer Brian Tyler teamed up with Koji Kondo to provide a score packed with recognizable tunes, complementing the mood of the film to a T and beyond.
I watched the pre-production version of the movie and made a list of which game music would work with each scene.
There's something we always talked about, is like, where can we put these pieces of music that reference the original while maintaining the cinematic version of Mario?
The end result is a glorious, lively love letter to fans of Super Mario and Nintendo games in general. That said, critical reaction was mixed, although most agreed that this film was a significant improvement over the live-action one. Others didn't see what the fuss was all about, especially faulting its admittedly simple story. But the Super Mario Bros. Movie was never meant to resemble something like Citizen Kane. It was meant to be a genuinely fun, lively crowd-pleaser, and audience response this time around was nothing short of ecstatic. Not only children, but many adult fans went to see the film multiple times. The result was a staggering $574.9 million at the domestic box office, making it the most successful film based on a video game. In fact, it was also the highest-grossing film of 2023 for a time, until it was toppled by Barbie. But still impressive all the same.
Yippee!
It It's not hard to see why the new film was such a monster hit, for the differences between the 93 version and the 2023 version are like night and day. The former was a troubled, misguided patchwork that didn't really know what it was supposed to be, made by people who never really understood the appeal of Super Mario. This one, on the other hand, was a labor of love from everyone involved. All were fans of the video games. Of course, having Mr. Miyamoto on board helped tremendously. Simply put, this was exactly the sort of film that fans wanted to see from the start. It might have taken several tries and a major misfire, but finally, the little plumber who could achieved success at the movies.
Now that's a happy ending.
Or is it?
Because everything's over now, and all that's left is you and the infinite void.
Kind of makes you want to play saxophone, huh?
That post-credits scene implies that we could very well see more adventures of Mario on the big screen. And then, of course, there are the games.
Here we go, off the rails. Did you know it's time to raise our sails? It's freedom like you never...
In any case, Mario has come a long way since his days as Jumpman in Donkey Kong. And whatever he stars in next, you can bet that audiences and gamers alike will keep on coming back for more. Even today, his popularity shows no sign of slowing down, and it's not difficult to see why. There are some facts that I unfortunately left out from this panel on account of time constraints, but other fans of Super Mario have created documentaries and web pages of their own, which feature even more behind-the-scenes stories. Here's a list of them. On that note, our celebration of Super Mario has come to an end. I hope you found it enjoyable and interesting, or at least, a journey down memory lane. I have other panels that I'll be doing online or in person at a con, covering other works, be it anime or video games. Until then, though, this is John Turner saying thanks for watching, and goodbye for now.
See you next time!